Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents This is God's Table, Finding Church Beyond the Walls, by Anna Woofenden, narrated by Vanessa Daniels. Foreword. If you pour yourself out for the hungry and satisfy the desire of the afflicted, then shall your light rise in the darkness and your gloom be as the noonday. And the Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your desire in scorched places and make your bones strong. And you shall be like a watered garden, like a spring of water, whose waters do not fail. And your ancient ruins shall be rebuilt. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to dwell in. Isaiah chapter 58, verses 10 through 12, English Standard Version. Those who take up the work of connecting faith with food, and with gardens for that matter, can find a great deal of support in Scripture. The Bible's abundant images of milk and honey, figs and olive trees, bread and wine, oil and cool water nourish our faith and remind us, like the first garden, of God's presence and love. But what the Bible also vividly describes is God's presence and love made manifest in the bodies of the lost and sick and humiliated, in crowded city marketplaces, in fights among neighbors and struggles over money, in the prayers of an afflicted woman and the songs of hungry people far from home. And this is the gift of the Garden Church and the gift of Anna Woofenden's tender and exact book to show it all and to help us move closer to wholeness. There was a woman named Anna, sent from God. She was not herself the light. She came to bear witness to the light. Alone, she crammed her little Honda full of pots and pans and books and gardening tools, found a cheap apartment in a rundown Southern California port city, rented an empty lot, tucked her hair behind her ears, and began to figure out the call. People ignored her. "I don't even get San Pedro," Anna told me, in one of her earliest and most prophet-like rants. "Why here? Who am I supposed to be talking to?" Luckily, since Anna didn't know who she was supposed to talk to, she talked to everyone. And since she didn't know exactly what she was supposed to do, she did it outdoors, building a garden where everyone could see. Anna was determined to open the gates to everyone who could possibly be hungering and thirsting for righteousness in San Pedro. The young Chicano barber, the cranky old Croatian lady, the shady real estate agent, the hopeless drunk, the afflicted single mother. She was meticulous about signs, centering the tree trunk as altar, creating the tender opening and closing of each liturgy, measuring the pace of silence and seasons, setting the table, trusting the sacraments. She poured herself out, feeding everyone who showed up, giving each the work they needed and asking all to break bread together, to pray for one another, to dig in the dirt and pull weeds side by side. And in God's own unpredictable, herky-jerky time, these strangers became a people growing toward the light. With wisdom and honesty, Anna has written it all down. This book is a gift for those longing to hear how to restore the streets, rebuild the ruins, repair the breach, and raise up the foundations of a new church. The Garden Church is like a spring whose water does not fail. It is rowdy and elegant, ancient and new, difficult and true. The call, Anna discovered, was simply what my grandparents and great-grandparents were called to as well, to discover what it means to be faithful in our generation, for this season, in this garden. She has planted in faith. May the work of her hands and the whole Garden Church be witness to the light. Sara Miles is an author whose books include Take This Bread, Jesus Freak, and City of God. She served as director of ministry at St. Gregory of Nyssa Episcopal Church in San Francisco for 10 years and is the founder and director of the Food Pantry. Chapter 1. The Table. The oil sizzled as I poured it over the surface of the cedar stump table sitting in the May sun. "We consecrate this table with the anointing of oil," I said as I continued pouring. "The oil that runs over the heads of those who are prophets and priests of God's message in the world. We anoint our table, the center of our worship space and our life together, with oil as it bears God's prophetic message to the world. This is God's table. All are welcome here." Our unlikely group was standing in the middle of an empty lot in the old town San Pedro, a neighborhood nestled in the southern outskirts of Los Angeles. On either side of us were the brick walls of neighboring buildings. Along the back of the lot, a sagging fence separated the space from a public parking lot. A green fence, accented with wrought iron grape leaves, opened to the street out front. Just a few hours before, in my jeans and black clerical collared shirt, I had walked out of the landlord's office with the code to the fence's padlock and the key for the water spigot. The office manager had given them to me nonchalantly. She had no idea what a monumental moment it was. I was about to open the gates of the garden church for the first time. Farmer Lara, a local master gardener I had been working with over the past months, walked to the site with me. We turned the numbers to the code on the padlock, opened the gates, and walked onto our lot, ours for the next 6 months at least. It was a plot of littered, hard-packed, scruffy dirt contaminated by years of parked cars and city waste. All we saw was potential and possibility. This was where the urban farm and outdoor sanctuary I had dreamed of for years would have its start. We were going to reimagine church here as we worked together, worshiped together, and ate together with all kinds of people. We would grow food, establish community, and connect with nature, God, and each other. This was it. Today was the day. Farmer Lara, with her big straw hat to protect her from the California sun, and I got to work. We stretched a carpenter's measuring tape across the 50-foot-wide plot, bringing to life the pencil sketches from my journal and the plans that Lara and her husband Scott and I had worked on around their kitchen table. We found the middle of the central circle we had envisioned and rolled the cedar stump over to it, scraping the ground so the stump would rest level. When I had gone to the garden center earlier that morning to pick up the stump, the man who cut it and sold it to me had asked, "What are you going to do with this, ma'am?" As the words came out of my mouth, I knew they were unexpected and perhaps a bit odd. "I'm starting a church that's in a garden. A garden that is a church." "Wait, so the church is like outside?"
"Exactly,"
I said with a smile, curious what he was thinking.
"So this stump is like church furniture."
"Well, now that will be neat," he said. "Yep. Come down and see it anytime," I replied. "We'll be in the empty lot on 6th Street, across the street and a bit down from the Warner Grand Theater." Karen had shown up as we were setting the stump in place. She had parked a few blocks away where the parking was free and slowly made her way with a cooler rolling behind her, filled with ice she had been making in her freezer all week. I first met Karen at Wayfarer's Chapel, our sister church up the hill in the next town over, when I was on a scouting mission to see if Los Angeles could be the place to plant the garden church. After preaching at Wayfarer's about this wild idea of a church in a garden and a garden in a church, Karen had come up to me after worship and said, "I see it. I really see it." When I arrived in August to bring the dream to life, she was one of the first people to seek me out, press a generous check into my hand, and say, "It's to grow the garden church." We'd met a few times over the fall, and she continued to pray for the work and ask the hard questions. "Is it really okay to be meeting in public parks? And do you know how rough that area of town is? How will it be funded? Do you really just move here and start this so quickly?" We talked through my research and my unanswered questions.
I was open about the anxiety that comes from starting a church from scratch. Karen was the perfect foil. I had the vision, but needed to know more about the heart of the community. And even though that vision may have been outside Karen's comfort zone, she had a heart for the community. Karen began coming to gatherings and worship as soon as we started. She showed up as we picked up trash in parks, planted lettuce seeds in pots to take home for our own dispersed garden, worshiped under a park tree, and learned to integrate the sounds of birds, sirens, and wind into the liturgy. We ate together, too. Everything from peanut butter and jelly sandwiches that Karen brought to the park to the big pots of soup that I made in my small kitchen as we gathered in my apartment to dream and plan and pray. Karen was part of setting the tone in those early months. Her heart was open, and she was willing to try, to learn, and to faithfully pray daily for God's guidance in this experiment of faith as we took the church beyond the walls. "Look at this place," she said as she began plopping ice into cups and pouring the juice she'd brought for each of us. "It doesn't look like much now, but I can see it, Reverend Anna. I can see it. This will be God's church." I got the rolled-up sign from the car, and Farmer Laura held it up on the front gate while I attached it with zip ties. With each tie, we secured ourselves a bit more to 6th Street. The sign read, "Pop-up Garden and Gathering Space, a collaboration between the Garden Church and Green Girl Farms, reimagining church as we work together, worship together, and eat together." We hung the sign, not realizing we were providing a blank canvas for graffiti to come. For now, it was crisp and new. Even as we hung it up, we began to make good on our hope that the location investment of renting this space was going to pay for itself in marketing. Right away, people walking by paused to ask what we were doing. We chatted with them, and Karen handed out postcards, sharing what we were doing and inviting people to join us. We attached a postcard holder to the front gate, and a week later, the first 100 cards were gone. People were curious about new activity in a lot that had previously been home to a few parked cars, sometimes a Christmas tree sale or beer fest, and always the faithful dino. Yes, that's right, a dinosaur. The lot was almost empty when we began renting it, but not quite. A 12-foot-tall, garishly green, metal dinosaur stood in the corner. Years before, the lot had held all sorts of large creature statues for sale. After the sale was over, Dino remained. Over time, the lot became identified as the Dino Lot, or sometimes Jurassic Park. Children and adults alike stood outside the fence, longing to say hello or get a photo with Dino. The group of people who had been overseeing and giving birth to our church plant over the past 14 months spent 20 minutes of the April board meeting deliberating whether Dino would stay or go. It certainly did not fit our hope for the decor, and it took up valuable growing space. Yet Dino was a fixture of the community we were joining. We decided to embrace the local, quirky nature of the predicament and claim Dino as part of our sanctuary. When asked about Dino in the months and years to come, we would say, "Dino was here before we were, so we let it stay. Look, we planted Dino its very own garden and converted Dino from a carnivore to an herbivore." Now that the gates were open, kids could run in and look up at the towering form. Teenagers came in to get selfies, and we chatted with adults who wanted to talk about the connections they saw between religion and science. Dino would become our ambassador, an icon in our space. Our sign was up. Our gates were open. I felt too excited to focus, but the lot was ours now, and there was much to get done that day. As we worked, Farmer Laura and I noticed how many people were coming by. Our street, 6th Street, held the weekly farmers market. People were hanging out, picking up lunch and produce. The sound of live music drifted down the street. We decided then and there we would be open every Friday during the market to welcome people into the space. I didn't know how exactly this would work. I just knew the gates needed to be open whenever there was a flow of people on the sidewalk. After our initial setup was complete, we had gathered around the cedar stump for a time of blessing. I watched the oil I'd poured on the table soak into the freshly hewn wood. Above the chatter of the shoppers at the produce stand outside the gate, I lifted my hands and prayed. As we open our gates, we ask you, O Lord, to watch over our going out and our coming in from this time forth and forevermore. May everyone who enters here feel your love and the love of the beloved community. May this be a space of refuge and sanctuary, delight and abundance, honoring God and peace. Alleluia. Amen. At our center, we consecrate the table that holds the symbols of our life together. The Bible, the Word of God, for the people of God. The candle, the light of Christ, and the light in all people. The water of life that nourishes and renews. The bread that feeds us, and the cup that reconciles us. And the icon of the tree of life, reminding us of why we are here, to cultivate a little more heavenly way of being, right here in the dirt of the earth. People poked their heads in, wondering what was going on. I smiled and waved as we sang Alleluia together. With each refrain, we became more and more of a church, a sacred sanctuary in the middle of the city. My voice caught as I poured the rest of the oil over the table. Years of calling, wonder, hard work, and a hope that this wild idea could be realized were culminating in this moment. This was the beginning of the church I had dreamed of pastoring. This is God's table, I repeated, where all are welcome to feed and be fed. Farmer Lara poured out parsley seed saved from her husband's grandmother's garden. As they scattered over the table, Lara voiced the remembrance of those who had come before us and put their faith in our efforts and our hope to grow something wonderful for the future. We committed ourselves to the new seeds we would plant and nurture here. Beside the stump, we had placed a rosemary bush in a big pot. Rosemary is traditionally for remembrance, the perfect companion for the communion table, where Christ calls us to celebrate and share the bread and the cup, and to do this in remembrance of me. Luke chapter 22, verse 19. Those of us gathered around the table took sprigs from the rosemary bush and dipped them in the water of the baptismal bowl, shaking the water toward each corner of the lot. We asked God's blessing and dedicated the lot as sacred space, a place where people could find hope, a table where everyone could find belonging. We named it as a church, a spiritual community dedicated to loving God and loving each other together and being faithful here and now in our generation. We were gathering in a centuries-old gesture of wanting to be a church together, but we were committing to doing it in a new way. It was not our intent to eschew tradition. Yet we knew many traditional churches weren't serving some people and were completely missing others. We prayed that the people who would never walk through the doors of a traditional church might find a home here at the Garden Church. After years of longing, wondering, and planning what it might look like to reimagine church in this way, here I was, in my new city, bringing it to life. The church has adapted from age to age to serve people in their local contexts. Monasteries, medieval beguines, prayer meetings, Catholic worker communities, all were new ideas once. Innovative expressions of Christian community were, and are, part of a loyal response to God's call to faithfulness. As the Garden Church moved from dream into dirt, people, and plants, I saw it as just one expression in a long lineage of contextually creative responses to being church together. As a church planter, I felt the temptation, and even pressure, to be the new thing that everyone could follow, thus saving the dying church. But God and the wise faithful continued to bring me back to earth. My job was the same as the generations of leaders and communities that have been reimagining church in their own time and place. My job was to ask, how can we come together with others who are looking to be faithful in our generation? How do we be church here and now in our current cultural context? The growing national trends around church and church-going loomed large over the work of the Garden Church. Or rather, the trends around not church-going. The number of nuns, those who claim no religious affiliation, and duns, those who once identified as religious but no longer do, in North America is growing. It is not as simple as stating that people just don't like church anymore. People cite not feeling welcome, the hypocrisy they see in religious traditions, and lack of engagement with the needs of the community and world around them. They say they practice their faith in other ways, but struggle with the idea of church. While many people have no interest in engaging in spiritual community, others are still searching for a place where they can connect in ways that nourish themselves and their families. And communities still long for the sacred and for church to be woven into the cracks and crevices and needs of the community. This is a story about the changing landscape of church, culture, and community. It is the story of our efforts to engage faith, food, and neighbors in ways that would enliven and transform us, rather than divide us. And it is a story of the challenges, tears, friendships, and love that arose in the process. We gathered around God's table in an empty lot, and a church sprang up. My calling to give this wild idea a try flowed from a central tenet. God is everywhere and moving in all things, and God is right here, present with us. So wherever we named and claimed God's expansive love and welcome, it would be church. I didn't anoint the cedar stump or table with frankincense oil that morning in the empty lot on 6th Street because I thought something magical would happen. I anointed it because we humans need physical things to remind us of what is deeply true. In biblical texts and Christian history, the practice of anointing with oil is usually reserved for priests, kings, prophets, and leaders. Anointing gives them permission to lead, to proclaim, to be prophetic witnesses. On that particular Friday, we did not pour oil over my head or Farmer Lara's. Instead, we poured it over the table. The table would be a place that we would continue to gather around. It would prophesy the deep truth that all are welcome around God's table. It would be the magnet that drew us together, the old friend that reminded us why we belonged, the symbol that radiated God's love. After I gave the very first benediction in our outdoor sanctuary, I opened a bag of almonds and apricots that I had stuffed in my purse while running out the door early that morning, and we ate together. TJ and Nancy walked into our outdoor sanctuary. TJ carried a watering can, gardening gloves, and a gift certificate to Home Depot. Nancy held a folder with some newspaper clippings and names of people I needed to connect with in the neighborhood. I had first met TJ and Nancy over a year before when I was scouting out the area as a possible place to plant the church. The embodiment of deep faith and hospitality, TJ had invited me to stay for 10 days in a studio apartment in the housing complex she helped manage while I researched the area. We sat in her cozy living room, and I shared the vision of creating a place where all different kinds of people could come together and be welcome. A place where we could eat together and get to know our neighbors. "Honey," she had said, "that's just what church should be." She described the potlucks at the church of her childhood and her belief that God guides and provides in the everyday things of life. TJ stayed to help welcome people in as they came through the gates to see Dino and ask what we were doing with this empty lot. I walked out to canvas the neighborhood with postcards and introduced the church. The other stayed back to continue cleaning up, bending to pick up broken glass and pull dry weeds from the packed gravel. As I returned through the gates, I saw people moving and working around the cedar stump that we had consecrated. I felt my breath quicken. This was a moment of arrival, the first of many that would come in the life of this church becoming a church. After months of planning, fundraising, wondering, hoping, doubting, and believing, here finally was our chance to see. What happens if you plant a church that is a garden and a garden that is a church? Who would gather around this table, God's table, where all were welcome? Chapter 2. Roots. I spent much of my life longing for a church where I felt fully welcome. The garden church is the main character of this book. And in this book, you will meet many of the people who nurtured, tended, and grew it alongside me. It has been my privilege and my work to plant this church, and now to tell the story of how it grew. Its origins are mingled with the soil of my own life. How we ended up on the hard-packed dirt of that Los Angeles lot has much to do with my own search for a church to be part of and to serve. I grew up on a homestead on an island in Washington State. There I played with and helped care for my six younger siblings, as eldest children in large families often do. I climbed trees, planted radishes and forget-me-nots in my own little garden bed, and built forts shaded by a big Douglas fir and old-growth cedar trees. I worked in the family garden as well, helping grow vegetables to add to the steady stream of groceries needed to keep us all fed. Living close to the land gave me many gifts. But at times it was also hard and lonely. Being homeschooled, coming from a large family, and living on an island a short ferry ride from the larger town set me apart. Wearing thrift store clothes and not having cool new toys added to my differences. I now appreciate that my parents encouraged us to read, make art, and play outdoors instead of watch television. At the time, I couldn't keep up with conversations with my peers about Full House or the latest music video. And then there was our religious heritage. We were part of the Swedenborgian Church, a statement that throughout my life has generally elicited the response, "Sweden what?" As a child, I didn't know the depth of my family's extended history with this small Christian movement. Nor have any idea that I would one day be ordained as a minister in one of the branches of the Swedenborgian Church. I only knew that because we were a part of this particular religious path, we didn't go to the church down the road, and we spoke of faith and God in different ways than some of my friends. Like many of you, no doubt, I have a complex religious family background. But I didn't know I was not alone in that complexity. At the time, I felt I was the only one who didn't quite belong. Both of my parents grew up in the Swedenborgian faith, although in divergent branches of the denomination, one more liberal and the other more conservative in theology and social norms. My father's family moved around the states until his father settled outside Boston for a long tenure as a professor at the Swedenborg School of Religion, the denominational seminary of the more liberal branch of the Swedenborgian tree. My grandmother, a brilliant theologian and scholar in her own right, although women in her day were not called theologians, had a minister father and a theologian mother. She raised eight children, developed Sunday school programming for the entire denomination, read New Testament Greek while knitting, and planted gardens at every house they inhabited. My mother's family moved frequently and attended Swedenborgian churches where they could. My grandparents eventually settled on an island in Lake Michigan, where they became integral to the local ecumenical community church and tended a huge vegetable garden and a flock of chickens near their small cabin. My parents met at a Swedenborgian college outside Philadelphia. They married in 1978. When spring came, they headed west in their 1965 VW bus with visions of finding a homestead, growing their own food, and putting down roots close to the land. they ended up on an island in the Puget Sound in northwest Washington. A long 2 hours from our island homestead was a Swedenborgian church in Seattle. When I was young, we made the drive there most Sundays. As we drove south, passing the church on our island and the many evangelical and mainline churches across the channel in town, it was reinforced to me that our branch of Christianity must be unique if we were making such an effort to worship there and not with our neighbors. As I look back now from a more ecumenical perspective, it is perhaps surprising that my parents made such an effort in those years to connect with the tradition they were raised in. Why not worship on the island with our neighbors? The Swedenborgian culture was our family lineage, the church we were taught to have allegiance to, even when across the country and far from the familiar. Being part of it, even in some small way, connected us to our extended family and the tradition they were dedicated to. But one Sunday, we didn't pile into the old VW and make the drive to Seattle. No one told me why. Years later, my parents would talk about the complicated struggle to feel part of the community, since we only attended once a week, along with the practical difficulty of the trip as our family grew in size. At the time, I only knew that I missed the music, lighting the candles, playing with friends, and rolling down the big grassy hill during coffee hour. Most people have never heard of the Swedenborgian church, but as a 6-year-old, it was the only church I really knew. The Swedenborgian church originated in a pub in London in the late 1700s when a group of men, mostly clergy, together read the theological works of an 18th century Swedish theologian and mystic, Emanuel Swedenborg. Some read Swedenborg's theology as research for their Sunday sermons in their Anglican churches. They were drawn to his concept of a layered reading of the Bible, his vivid descriptions of life after death, and his unusual acceptance of various religious paths. Another group took Swedenborg's vision of a new Christianity as a call to start a new denomination. They were Baptists and Methodists, street preachers and reformers, eager to start a movement. This latter group began training and ordaining clergy and establishing churches. The seeds of their vision crossed the ocean and took root in North America, where they founded what is now named the Swedenborgian Church of North America in Philadelphia in 1817. As a nation established in part on freedom of religion, the young American Republic was awash in a sea of religious movements and groups, albeit most of them Christian. Within this context, many Americans felt empowered to leave existing religious communities and join new ones, especially communities that emphasized direct religious experiences. Methodists, Baptists, Mormons, Disciples, and Shakers were all groups who, in varied ways, said that God was still speaking to people, especially ordinary folks. And these groups grew at astounding rates in the first decades of the 19th century. In Philadelphia, the Swedenborgian tree flourished in this fertile soil. After a few generations, a branch split off. People who craved a new life apart in an intentional religious community. They moved to a wooded hill on the outskirts of Philadelphia to create a utopian community and schools exclusively for children in the church. My maternal grandmother would be born in this town, where she would make her way through the tree-lined paths up to the Gothic-style cathedral on the hill for worship every Sunday. Later, my parents would walk these same paths while attending the college where they met. After we stopped going to the church in Seattle regularly, we began having family worship at home instead. We pulled chairs into a circle, sang, read from the Bible, and said the Lord's Prayer. I always wanted to be involved, and my leadership skills began to emerge as I shared how I thought worship should go. It was sweet to gather as a family in this way, but my world had suddenly gotten smaller, and I missed our church community. I found joy in working in our big garden. I found peace and curiosity playing in the woods, building forts, and climbing trees with my siblings. This nurtured me. But while I didn't have the words for it at the time, looking back, I see signs of my longing for a consistent spiritual community. I longed for others with whom I could freely ask my questions about God and do Sunday school lessons. I missed those home-baked cookies at coffee hour. We sometimes gathered with other dispersed Swedenborgians in the greater area around the holidays or when a guest minister from out of town would visit. Sometimes we'd make the trek to the Swedenborgian family camp in the Northwest, or to the camp in Maine that my father's grandparents had founded. Then, as a preteen, I started to rebel against my parents by going with my friends to the evangelical youth group in town. My parents were glad to see me finding community, but uncomfortable with the accompanying theology. I, however, was discovering the intimacy of prayer, and I began going to the Bible regularly to hear God's voice. We had weekend retreats and weekly discipleship groups. I was told that people were proud of me and grateful for my contributions. I was empowered to lead. As a teenager, this sense of being part of something was paramount. Yet this was not the full answer to my desire for belonging. I could never completely relax within this community. At the time, I fell in line with the evangelical moral and cultural norms, but the theology stung and chafed. I embraced the people, but kept my background and questions under wraps. If I wanted to belong, I needed to belong on their terms, theologically, morally, and culturally. I always watched myself. I was on edge. For my youth pastors, there was only one way to God and heaven. Unless you proclaimed Christ in a particular way, you were damned to hell. Yet at home, I was taught about a God who welcomed all different kinds of people into heaven, and that it was both our belief and the way we lived that mattered. I was leading a double theological life. It seemed the only way to survive. The evangelical church was my friend group and my community. But I felt sure, and I may have been absolutely right, that I would no longer be accepted if I were honest about my questions, my theological concerns, and my heart of heart knowing and beliefs. My God was different from their God. I had no place to put this truth. With a Swedenborgian backdrop behind me and the church of my teenage years not the answer either, the tension between my worlds grew. Throughout high school, I felt a hunger to learn more about the Swedenborgian theology of my family tree. I applied to the same college my parents had attended. At 18, I arrived there with an open heart and quickly soaked up theology classes, all college worship, and conversations over meals at the dining hall. I was so excited to be around people with whom I could talk openly about my love for Swedenborgian concepts. I led Bible studies and worked on church outreach. My calling to ministry began to sprout. Like my grandparents, aunts, and uncles before me, I was called to the life of faith and exploring theology with others. But as this path unfolded, I began feeling constraints. I spotted signs I had somehow failed to notice along the way. The lack of women in spiritual leadership, the socially conservative, sheltered, and restrictive culture. Just as I had felt in my youth pastor's living room during Bible study with my friends, I began to wonder if there was enough room for my questions and for what I thought I might have to offer my church. A few years after college graduation, I got my dream job as an outreach director at a church in Boulder, Colorado. Although the church was part of the same conservative branch of the denomination, it was committed to doing church in new and welcoming ways. If there was going to be a place for me in this denomination, this church was it. In Colorado, I bought a townhouse, dug out the landscaping rocks in my little square of yard outside the front door, and planted a garden to see what I could grow. I dove into my new role. As I grew, my call to ministry grew as well. I loved being present with people in pastoral care situations, and found I had a good sense of welcoming people into a community, removing barriers, and leading small groups. I discovered my ability to help create and cast a vision for what church could be. I found home and community nestled near the Rocky Mountains. But I was drawn to activities beyond the scope of my non-ordained role, engaging deeply with theological study and teaching, preaching, leading worship, and presiding over the sacraments. I was finally forced by my own inner truth to question my belonging in an organization where I, as a woman, could not be ordained. My job description hadn't narrowed. My call was widening. The questions that surfaced were not just about my own sense of what God was leading me toward. I was also wrestling with questions like, what is the church anyway? How can we speak of spiritual nourishment when there are empty stomachs sitting in our pews? Where do justice and mercy fit in? These questions were the early etchings of a church, a spiritual community, a ministry to which God was calling me. The call became louder, and the need to move on from my congregation and denomination became clearer. I wanted to pursue ordained ministry. God's message, "Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations," Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, kept appearing in front of me until all I could hear was "Go." I transferred my membership to the more progressive and inclusive branch of the Swedenborgian family tree and applied for the ordination track in the Swedenborgian Church of North America. From the outside, this might seem like an easy transition to have made, leaving one Swedenborgian community for another. But the divide between them was notable. As someone with heritage in both, I had felt the animosity between the two branches my whole life. In leaving one and going to the other, there was loss and the feeling of betrayal. I also found connection and new beginnings. I was preparing to follow in the footsteps of so many of my father's relatives. People recognized my last name. They recalled taking classes from my grandfather, or were reading my great-grandmother's books of biblical exegesis. This community welcomed me with open arms. Here, my gender was no longer a barrier to my calling. I also suddenly found myself among Swedenborgians who engaged and existed within a larger ecumenical world. As I pursued a degree and ordination, I was encouraged to explore and see how this tradition fit within the history and movement of the broader Christian family tree. Sojourning with the Quakers, I earned my Master of Divinity at the Earlham School of Religion. I studied at the Center of Swedenborgian Studies in Berkeley, surrounded by a plethora of traditions in the Graduate Theological Union. I washed feet and explored ritual and preaching with the Church of the Brethren. I spent a summer in Washington, D.C., with an ecumenical cohort of Beatitude Society Fellows, and worked at the faith-based food justice advocacy organization, Bread for the World. I did fieldwork at St. Gregory of Nyssa Episcopal Church and the food pantry in San Francisco. I went to a church planters conference where most of the speakers were women, from all over the denominational spectrum, showing me that this could be my story. My world widened. My appreciation for the many and varied branches of the Christian tree grew. I began to feel more and more at home, drawing on a variety of traditions to flesh out what it looked like to be the body of Christ. The things that divide us, exactly how to preside over the table, membership, baptism, theological particularity, seemed less and less important to me. The Episcopalians taught me the power and depth of liturgy and the centrality of the Eucharist, Holy Communion. The Quakers taught me the power of silence and the importance of contemplation and action in the work of justice and peacemaking. The Brethren lifted up the priesthood of all believers. The Lutherans gifted me with seeing the power of a church planter who could create a community around her explorations of the Lutheran theology, that everyone is simultaneously sinner and saint. My Presbyterian mentor showed me how the structure of the mainline church opens up a space for women to be ordained fully into leadership. I found myself identifying with the broader and varied progressive Christian movements, while centered in the Christian tradition of my ancestors, but now in a form expansive and inclusive of a variety of paths. While a part of me felt like I never quite fit in anywhere completely, I still needed to explain Swedenborgian to the wider world. I was finding my way and feeling part of the body of Christ. In each of these traditions, I gravitated toward people who were asking questions about food and faith, ecology and theology. I studied how the sacrament of communion had been used to include and to exclude throughout history. I explored the work of Helen Keller. While she is perhaps most well known for her humanitarian activism, including for the deaf and blind, she was also a devout Swedenborgian whose spirituality led her to works of justice and beauty as she connected with God and nature. I dedicated a seminary New Testament paper to exploring who might have been with Jesus at the Last Supper, making a case for a crew of disciples from varied walks of life that could have surrounded him. I took every chance I got to have communion and share a meal with a different religious group. The sacrament of breaking bread together at a table captured me wherever I was, giving me a moment of belonging. As I sojourned through school, trainings, and internship placements, I tried to plant at least a few pots on the back stoop of every place I lived, if not a whole garden. I kept an eager eye out for growing space in cities and towns. I found something sacred in seeing how nature persists in urban environments, and I always looked for ways to grow more food in proximity to those who were going to eat it. And I sought out church planters and people who were experimenting with church in new ways. I made my way to the House for All Sinners and Saints in Denver, and to St. Lydia's, a dinner church in Brooklyn. I met with founding pastors and read every book, social media post, and website I could get my hands on that explored church planting and doing church in creative ways. The vision began to sharpen. Food, community, sacrament and prayer and singing. People fed in body, fed mentally and emotionally, fed in spirit. I do not remember the exact day the idea for the garden church took shape, but what I do remember is sitting across from a seminary professor at a coffee shop and saying, "What if everyone got their hands dirty? What if we had church in a garden where we grew our own food?" It was during seminary that I also began to understand better the multi-layered...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.